Good morning, everybody. We thank the Egyptian Vitreoretinal Society. We'd like to thank Dr. Ahmed Mustafa. And this symposium is on facts and myths in the management of diabetic retinopathy.
Not the usual case, but you can see them in some cases.
Yes, in some cases. But as a guideline, if you have a systolic edema 400, 6 vision, and the patient is complaining, would you treat or not?
Still questionable. I think Dr. Ahmed Suka will answer this question.
No, I'm asking you.
6 vision?
Yes.
I will not treat. I will not.
Complaining, not quality.
No. Control your blood sugar, come after 3 months.
Actually, I wouldn't look for a better introduction for this talk. It's exactly this question and exactly the introduction of Dr. Sharif. Today, I'm going to discuss the protocol V-Results, which is addressing this point specifically, symptomatic or not, visual acuity better than 6-9, very complex situation. And unlike what we thought before, it's a very common situation because of screening patients in Egypt specifically by OCTs whenever they have diabetes, and we're looking at the fundus, they look good, they're 1.0 vision, 6 over 6. Everybody does fluorescein and OCT, and oops, they have macular edema. It's a problem, really. The DRCR guiding us through diabetic patients, marvelous randomized controlled studies, protocol V addressing this issue specifically, looked into the issue. Because previous trials started recruiting patients when they have visual acuity of 6-12 or less. It wasn't aiming that we will not treat patients having 6-6 or 6-9 vision, but it was the recruitment plan only. So the results were very nice, very specific, but did not address patients of 6-9 vision, 6-6 vision. So they started looking into this. Why? Because in ETDRS previously, they had lots of cases actually with high visual acuity included in the trial. And they were either observed or lasered at the time. And you could see that laser was a bit better because only 27% of these patients lost 5 letters instead of observing them, and in 40% of patients you lose the 5 letters. So it's a lot of patients. Giving laser goes down to around 27%. Looking at some high visual acuity patients in the DRCR protocol I cases, this dropped to 5%. So what were our strategies that we could think of when we meet these patients? Either we'll give injections and treat the edema to get rid of it, or we might give laser and observe the patient. If it is worse, then we start injections, or we simply observe the patient and look for this drop in visual acuity, and then we start our injections. These are the three possible strategies when you meet this patient. Here, we are comparing if we give the laser to simple observation, because the question whether laser will be better or not was not still answered. Recruitment of patients in this fashion, as we mentioned, and the regimen in real life is observing the patient. This means monitoring and visiting, looking at visual acuity, and we rescue by anti-VEGF. Or giving the laser and still monitoring the patient and looking at visual acuity every 2 months and giving injections when it drops. Or he's complaining, maybe we don't like the edema, start the injections and let's see. Important is to remember, you have to monitor visual acuity. And it's not OCT, it's only visual acuity. This is a burden that's off. You don't do OCTs regularly. You look at the vision only. And never give a laser and stop monitoring and think that everything is fine. How about the results of these recruitment strategies? All three groups, by the end of 2 years, did not lose vision more than any other. Meaning, the three strategies do not lead any one of them to worse patients. So you can do the three. Any one of them is okay. How did the vision fare over the 2 years? Well, by the end of 2 years, nothing was significant. The three groups using these strategies was okay. However, at 1 year, it was significantly better vision statistically when you start the injections early, meaning that these patients spent 2 years seeing better than the ones who were only observed until the drop and injected, or lasered until they drop and inject it. So still questions remain. However, you can delay your start of treatment until the visual acuity drops because there is no loss of vision by the end of 2 years if you do that. So you do not have to treat these patients. Monitoring is the important thing, and you do not tell the patients that your strategy is not injecting. The strategy is actually that we will inject when you drop in visual acuity and it becomes significant. So the hallmark is monitoring and visual acuity only. How did they look, these patients? Of course, injected patients early had better anatomy because they were simply injected that early. Observation groups and laser groups, by the end of 2 years, was similar in vision and anatomy. Why? Because the ones who had significant drop in vision were also injected and the anatomy was improved also. And some minority had drop in the thickness without even treating, as Dr. Shreve presented in one of these cases. So why is it similar? It's just discussed it. And leaving them without injections was not the cause of improvement in anatomy. It's because some of them were selected and injected. Okay, another question comes up. Maybe, if you give laser, for example, and you wait, and the one patient still has a drop in visual acuity, worsening of the edema, and you start injecting, maybe you use here less number of injections because of the previous laser at the beginning of this monitoring period. All patients who needed injections along the 2 years because of this visual acuity drop, or if you decided from the start to inject from the start, all of them received the same average number of injections over the 2 years, 8 injections in average. So actually, using any strategy did not lead to less number of injections, even if you add laser at the beginning. So, this is my summary, and the previous slides were all DRCR slides. The three strategies are not causing loss. Okay, fine. It is not a monotherapy, meaning you don't give laser and say this is the treatment of the edema. You are monitoring for the drop, and if it happens, you add your injections. Observation alone can end in injections if they drop. Most eyes in the observation group and the laser group at the beginning did not need injections, most of them. 3/4 of the laser group and 2/3 of the observation group without statistical significance between both. This means that if you inject all patients, more than 2/3 of them are unnecessarily injected. They would have stayed in the 6-6 area, 20-25 area, even without the injections. 1/4 to 1/3 of them will need the injections over the 2 years. Another question is laser. It's becoming more useless because it did not cause statistically significant more patients not needing injections, so we did not benefit here. It did not even reduce the number of injections if the patient needed them, so it didn't reduce anything. It actually had no use over the observation group. In my simple conclusion, if the patient is asymptomatic, you choose a strategy of observation. And when the patient drops in visual acuity to 6/12 or less, you start your injections. And it would be the same number of injections if you started early. But if the patient is complaining, because I have patients who could not function normally, although they are 6/6 in my clinic, but they are the ones complaining and saying, I'm not reading well, I'm not working well, I'm not happy. These ones I do inject because it's the same number of injections, but they lead a happier life over the 2 years. Why would the patient be sometimes symptomatic or not? Because we are screening patients with OCT even if they are not complaining. And that's the point where you find the macular edema, although the patient was not complaining. At this point, I would say observe, look for the progress over the 2 years only by vision, no more OCTs, and when they drop, you inject. This is the publication of the DRCR and all these results are the DRCR protocol V results. Thank you.
Thank you, Ahmed. I have a question for you. This is an excellent protocol by the DRCRnet, and I think this is maybe the only protocol that favors the visual acuity over the anatomy of the macula in decision making for treatment of diabetic macular edema. And in real life practice, you see a lot of our colleagues who treats patients based on just OCTs, okay? Mm-hmm. And like Dr. Shreve just emphasized in the case that he presented, that you can have such a huge edema with a very good visual acuity. So it's important to deliver the message that we have to check the visual acuity of the patients, not just the decision of the one who writes the report of the OCT. This is center involving diabetic macular edema with such a thickness, so it goes directly to maybe a general ophthalmologist or someone who's not a retina specialist, and he just injects the patient unnecessarily. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying he's harming the patient, but if anything goes wrong, like endophthalmitis or other complications of injections,
of course,
I think this could have been avoided.
Of course.
Right?
Yeah. The message here would be simply that you inject lots of patients with different diagnoses, meaning diabetic macular edema is one of them, another is RVO, vein occlusions, and another is AMD, CMVs. The most diagnoses like AMD and RVO depend on OCT, and you have to reach dryness on OCT, and it's simple to follow the OCT. Diabetic macular edema is different. There is discrepancy between your targets. The vision is the target and not the edema. You have patients who did not change in macular edema, but they had improvement in vision, significant and clear. The target is not total dryness in diabetic macular edema, unlike the other pathologies. So it is a bit complicated, but it is dependent on visual acuity much, much more than the OCT, of course.
Can I have a quick question in 1 second?
Yes, okay.
Dr. Ahmed, you said if the vision drops, you start injecting.
Yep.
And I agree with that totally. But in between the lines in the paper, would you start injecting PRN or start injecting the three loading dose?
The injection protocol is the same, whatever the situation. It's very similar to protocol T. Yes, of course, you load here, I load three. Actually, the RCR suggests more, 5 to 6, actually. But most of us are practicing three initial loading. Yes, I give the three, of course.
Well, once the vision drops.
Yep.
Thank you.
وبنشكر الشانس الجمعية التعليم المستمر ادتها لنا كجمعية الشبكية to pinpoint those important points. Thank you very much.